then wilt thou not be loath to leave this paradise, but shalt possess a paradise within thee, happier far. The very last words that Michael will say to Adam is, you are leaving paradise, but if you have the appropriate vision, paradise never leaves you. I just want to point out the hopeful nature of this kind of view by Milton, that although our poem is ending kind of sad and tragic, it's also a poem of hope, and that I think is important to articulate as well. At line 594, they go down the mountain to wake up Eve, but Eve is already awake. But this wake Eve at line 594, Michael will tell him, go wake Eve, will remind us of book 5 when at line 20, Adam woke up Eve. At line 606, she's already awake. Again, the argument will be a little bit off. And Eve's words at line 614 are worth our reading. She says it, wearied I fell asleep, but now lead on. In me is no delay. With thee to go is to stay here. Without thee here to stay is to go hence unwilling. Thou to me art all things under heaven, all places thou, who from my willful crime art banished hence. At line 619, we are back to Milton and his patriarchal understandings. In other words, after Eve has her little foray into gaining some knowledge, she will say, forever I will stand next to my man. Milton, of course, is providing us with the patriarchal argument that we began with in our lectures back in book 4. Go back and look at some of those comments that we made about the importance of maybe challenging that idea in the 20th and the 21st century, as we talked about Tilly Olson's Silences and other really important feminist voices that say, is this really the way that we want to think about the world's being arranged as an organic whole, where women are always subjugated to their men to be told what to do by them? Finally, some just fun bits of knowledge. Line 629, we have our last simile in an epic poem that has been replete with similes. We meet our last one. And finally, at 637, the very end of the poem. Now, I'm going to ask you in a little bit, and this is fun. I'm going to ask you, this is an epic poem, right? Milton said that he wanted to rival Homer, the Iliad, the Odyssey, and Virgil, the Aeneid. Of course, these are poems we've studied together already. So I'm going to ask you this question as we finish this. How is the final lines of Paradise Lost similar to the end of the Iliad, the Odyssey, and the Aeneid? How is it quite different? I think we're going to see it's quite different. Let's take a look. Starting at line 637, whereat, in either hand, the hastening angel, Michael, caught our lingering parents, they're not excited to leave, obviously, paradise, and to the eastern gate led them direct down the cliff as fast to the subjugated plain, then disappeared. He's holding them by the hands, in either hand, he holds them, and off they go. They, Adam and Eve, looking back, that would make sense. Now they're now that they've left, right? Think about the cinematography here if you wanted to do this in film. Looking back, all the eastern side beheld of paradise, so late their happy seat. Waved over by that flaming brand, they're not ever going to be able to go back because of the angels. The gate with dreadful faces thronged and fiery arms. Some natural tears they dropped, and of course we've had tears all the way back, of course, to Eve waking up from her bad dream when the toad Satan is going to have planted in her mind some kinds of bad feelings, and those two drops that fell. Milton was already setting us up for the end of the poem here. Some natural tears they dropped, but wiped them soon. You'll remember earlier, Adam wiped Eve's away with her hair. The world was all before them, where to choose. Think about our argument for free will, their place of rest, and Providence, capital P, their guide. They, hand in hand, we think about the fact that all of the development of Adam and Eve as characters can be mapped, can be tracked by the way they either hold hands, don't hold hands. Remember when she leaves, she lets go. Or when Adam seizes, grabs hold with her hands before, after the fall, the moment of their sex after the fall, right? Hand in hand, with wandering steps is an interesting word. Think about the way wandering has been used throughout this poem. And slow, now they're cautious, whereas before maybe not so cautious. Through Eden, took their solitary way. Solitary, of course, will remind us that constantly we've been listening the use of the word alone over and over again. And of course, the word way being the last word of the poem. I mean, path, way, right? We think, of course, of even the word yoga out of the Sanskrit to mean a path or a way, a journey. In other words, a journey is still in front of them, another journey. All right, well, let's quickly do some level 2 and 3 work here as we finish now. Themes, messages at 2A, several, right? Out of bad can come good. The propedeutic nature of suffering, as we saw at line 569. How about this one? The idea that history is a great teacher. We quoted the great Santayana who said, those who forget the past are damned to repeat it. That is to say, trying to think about the ways that history can lead us to understanding. Of course, another major message is the leaving of Eden. It's easier in our poem if we're together, if we have a pal, if you will. They have learned important stuff, and now, of course, they're ready to move on. At 2B, the idea of rhetoric, not what Milton says, but how he says it. Let's just point out several. We mentioned the last simile, so let's say it. Of course, the epic similes, they're amazing throughout this. We met those ones in the very first book with Satan, and now here we are at the very end as we are talking about similes. Of course, we have all kinds of symbolism. Eden itself becomes a symbol of any number of ideas, right? Think about the speeches of this great epic. We immediately think of other epics, but we as well think, and I tried to say this before, because in the Harvard Classics, remember, I gave lectures on specifically the dialogues of Apology, of Crito, of Phaedo. We have powerful speeches going on here, and these speeches are Milton's mouthpiece. Think about that. He can, as Milton, can use Michael the Archangel to make arguments that if you disagree with those arguments, you are not disagreeing with Milton, you are disagreeing with God. It's a compelling idea, right? At level 3A, the relationship to other texts. Okay, we kind of predicted this. How about the end of other epics? Think about, for example, the way the Iliad, the Odyssey, and the Aeneid end. For example, at the end of the Iliad, the very final lines, Hector's burial. Why has Hector got to be buried? Because, of course, there was a war. How about the end of the Odyssey? Well, of course, Athena's got to come down and institute a certain kind of peace pact. Why? Because everybody's ready to slaughter each other. Think about the end of the Aeneid, maybe the most compelling end of all of the epics, where you have Aeneas standing there with his sword, right? Turnus is actually begging for his life, or at least saying, you know, okay, I give up. And because of what Turnus has done, Aeneas is just going to jack him. And that's the way that the poem ends. Think about it. All three of those epics, which are, of course, the holy trinity of epics in the Western tradition, all end with some kind of war, some kind of killing death, and some kind of cessation of that. Of course, we have a different kind of ending in Paradise Lost, right? We have life, we have at least some kind of suggestion of hope coming in the future. And what is lost here is not physical death, but of course innocence. Think about this one for 3A. What kinds of movies best show the loss of Eden or Paradise for you? What's your favorite song, maybe, that is or text that shows how all things have to change and evolve? Finally, of course, the importance of Plato's Republic can't be overstated, both in his understanding of the tripartite view of the soul, and reason has to lead emotion and desire, and of course the declension of state, as we've already mentioned. To relate this to self, how about this one? The Greeks love that story myth about Daedalus Icarus, where the father Daedalus tells Icarus, don't fly too close to the sun, the wax will come off your wings and you'll jack into the sea. Think about the ways in which the words of advice are being given, of course, to Adam through Michael or whatever. And the obvious question is, how much of that do you really want to pay attention to, right? Of course, we'll always try and reflect back in our own stories about how old people have given us suggestions that either we listened to or we did not listen to. One of my favorite is the old man who wanted to caution me to be very careful when I was about to do something kind of crazy. And he said it, although it's not a very nice thing to say, but he said it. He said, look, son, anybody can piss into the wind. The secret's to keep from getting wet. I share that with you simply because that was a profound statement, even though obviously it's not very polite, but it's an interesting idea. In other words, you know, you got to think before you act, and of course we see that in Paradise Lost, don't we? How about this one? Is this a good enough ending for you at 3B? Do you think of it as a love story? Are you frustrated at a subdued Eve who is not more willing to stand up for herself and fight back? Does that make you mad? How about this one? How was it that it was all right there in the opening lines? Now that you've made it to the end of this epic with me, let me make one suggestion. Let's go back in one final lecture and let's look at the opening lines of the poem and ask if now we can read them in a different way. Remember when we did our study of Hamlet? In the opening lines, and I said it, who's there, the opening line, and I said, you're not really going to fully appreciate the opening lines of Hamlet until you get all the way to the end. The rest is silence. And then you're going to come back, and you're going to look at that who's there line, and you're going to be able to understand that Shakespeare was playing all kinds of games. The same is true for Milton. And I'm going to make the argument that Milton was in full awareness of some of the things that he was doing, playing off of especially two really important British literary figures. I think the two most important, along with Milton, Chaucer, and Shakespeare. Come back. We'll do a brief summary lecture number 27. I'll see you in a few moments. Thank you.